Okay, so I'm Henning Thorsen, and some of you might know me from IRC, named as Batman. So this talk is Batman's utility belt, which is some of the common tools I use every day. I checked my console log, or the log in my terminal, to see what kind of applications I run. And mostly it's like 5 applications I run every day, most of the time. And those are Git, Ack, Vim, Less, and TT. I guess you know a lot about the first 4, but maybe you don't know about TT. So that's one of the first applications I'm going to present. So app.tt is an the application is used to register your hours. And I got interested in command line tools for registering my hours after finding the another program called App Time Tracker. But it was based on Moose, so it was really, I mean, it took like a couple of seconds to start up. And I feel like command line tools should be really snappy. And also I wanted another interface for the tool, so that's why I wrote my own TT application. But even though it's completely different, it uses the same storage. It's pretty much plain JSON files. So that means that if you want to use any of the time tracker plugins for integrating with the other third parties, then you can use those to manipulate the same files. So what I do, and also if the text is a little bit small, then you can see my slides online afterwards. But basically the way I use it is that I say TT start, and if you don't specify a project with the -p, then it's going to use the current directory you're in to register that as the project you're working on. So that means that you can, let's say if you're tracking your open source time in the evening, and then you can track your work hours, and you can track different projects if you like. The second command, if you just write TT, then it's going to give you the status about if you're working on something or if you're not working on something. But if you are working on something, then it's going to tell you how long you've been working. So let's say if your regular day is 8 hours, then you can see that, okay, you've been working on demo for 8 hours, 10 minutes, and 15 seconds, so it's about time to get home. The next command is just TT stop. So I guess you can guess what that does. It's going to stop tracking that project. And then to figure out how many hours you've done that month or week or year, you can use the log command. And then if you have a lot of different projects, let's say if you're a consultant or something, and you want to filter out time tracked for a specific project, then you can use that with -p. And it's going to give you a long list of all the dates and how long you've been working, the name of the project, and also you can use tags if you like to dig deeper into the specification of what kind of things you've been working on. And if this is a little bit hard to remember, then the last two commands is tt-h and tt some kind of subcommand -h. It's going to give you examples on how to use the applications. Okay, next up, it's app git-ship. And that's a tool for creating new Perl modules, but also to ship your code to cpanm. So to be able to ship anything to cpanm, you need a .pause file in your home directory where you add your username and password. And then after that, you can use git-ship start to create a new project. So you specify the main module that you're working on, and then it's going to make a new directory and add some boilerplate, like a changes file, basic tests, and a cpanm file, and create that module that you just specified. So step 3 is something we all have to do. That is to actually edit the file to add some code. And then you edit the changes file to tell the users of your project what to do, what you've done. And then hopefully you would like to write some run some tests using prove. And then after that, you can use git-ship build to build your project. And then you can see the content of that content of that package. And then at the end, you can just ship it. So what I like about this tool is that you don't have to use this tool. It's not like other tools that you might have used. It requires you to write your modules in a specific way, or it requires you to like install a bunch of modules. This script is just so I don't have to remember all of those 4 or 5 steps that you have to do manually each time. So it's non-intrusive. So let's say if someone makes a pull request to your project or something like that, then they don't have to worry about what kind of tool you use to actually ship the module. app-git-ship is, you can extend it. So let's say if you would like to use it in a closed environment at work, you can create a new sub-module to push your code to, let's say, a local repository or any other way you want to ship your code. So I like to write git-ship. I like to ship stuff, so that's why I created that tool to be extensible. So like I said, you have to make that, you have to edit your module, of course, but writing documentation can be quite tedious. So if you want a tool which can create the documentation for you, you can use app podify. And what it's going to do is it's going to look into that file and it's going to figure out all the attributes and all the methods, and it's going to make all the boilerplate for you. So instead of writing head one name, head one synopsis, head one methods and attributes and all of that things that is really boring, you can use that tool and it's going to spit out all the boilerplate documentation. You can use -i, which is going to which will overwrite that module, or if you don't feel adventurous, if you want to be on the safe side, you can run it without -i and it's going to print it out to standard output. So you can investigate what it's actually going to do. So before shipping the project, I said that it would be nice to run some tests. So most people have probably used prove to run their test suite. But sometimes since Perl is very easy to start up and everything is quick and smooth, then I like to fiddle around in my test file and in my libraries just to figure out like adding warn messages or something like that and then rerun the tests. But then I have to do the changes, jump to another shell, and then run prove. And I think that's very boring. So that's why I wrote prowess, which will watch the unit test file, but also any file or directory that you tell it to using -w. So whenever a file in that directory or the test file changes, it's going to rerun the test. And also, sometimes if you're writing, let's say if you're writing some non-blocking code, and your test suite just stops in some random place because you forgot to add a callback or something weird like that, then it will kill the running test and then start a new run. So it will never hang forever. Okay, so Perl Tidy. I think code formatting is a sensitive subject for a lot of people. And I wonder how many hours every year people sit down and discuss this topic, like, where should I put my curly brackets? 4 spaces, 2 spaces, I don't know. There's so many discussions around this. And I like to write my own code without using Perl Tidy for a long time. And me and Marcus Ramberg, we were working on a project. And I think he spent maybe 2 years convincing me to use Perl Tidy. And I'm so happy that I finally came around, because now we don't have to discuss how to write the code. It will just look in a standard way anyways. And I mean, we could still bicker around about what kind of rules we should use. You want to have 80 characters, 100 characters, 400 characters per line. I mean, you can use so many hours on this. But what I like about this is that, let's say if you check out a repository that already have a Perl tidy file, then you could run your own specification on it. So let's say if you're not agreeing with the team, you could just run through all the code with your own rules, and then you can start editing the file. And then afterwards, when you check it in, you have to make sure that you run it with the Perl tidy file for the project. But I think this is a nice way, so everybody gets happy about the contract about how to write the code. But how do you remember to run Perl tidy every time before you check it in? Well, there's a tool on cpanm called git-hook Perl tidy. So if you run that script, git-hook Perl tidy install, then it's going to install a pre-commit hook. So every time you try to commit your code, it's going to Perl tidy it. So that means that you can never commit anything that doesn't look the way the team has agreed on. And also, if your editor is clever, then you could add a read hook that can run the Perl tidy when you load the code into your editor, which I find very neat. Okay, there's another tool. It doesn't have anything to do with Perl, but sshuttle is a tool where you can make sure that your local computer sends traffic through a jump host. So it's pretty neat. Let's say if you have if you're working remotely and you need to access certain servers in the office or in, let's say, in a Google Cloud or DigitalOcean private network, then you can run sshuttle to the jump host. And then you can specify what kind of networks you want to tunnel through that jump host before accessing the actual servers. So in the first example, you're very specific about what kind of network. I mean, slash 20, maybe you're not so specific, but at least you're specifying that a specific range should go through that server. The next example, you just say, OK, all my traffic should go through that server. And let's say if you're in a coffee shop somewhere and you don't want people to sniff your traffic, then you could set up some kind of Linux server somewhere and you could tunnel all your traffic through your own server, for example. The last example here with the dash dash DNS also makes all the DNS requests go to that jump host. So normally, it's going to send all the DNS requests to whatever DNS that your ISP provides, or 888, or 1.1.1, whatever you're using. But using that switch means that you will also send those requests to that jump host. And that could be nice, let's say, if all of your internal servers are registered into a DNS server that is not reachable from the internet. Okay, the last tool is the tool that I use to write these presentations. There's a JavaScript framework called Remark.js, which will read some sort of markdown files, and it's going to render it in a way that looks like a slideshow. So it's not too fancy what you're seeing here, but that's one of the things that I really like. Whenever I'm using, let's say, Present or whatever Microsoft tool that someone might use, it's so easy to get distracted from all the fonts you can select, font sizes, I don't know, colors, background images, whatever. And instead of focusing on that, I just want a slideshow that renders my slides or the information I want to convey in a nice way. And then I can focus in a distraction-free environment in my editor, just writing Markdown instead. So I would suggest checking out Remark.js. And if you want to run that locally, you can download the app Remark.pl, which you can start like this. You just say Remark.pl and the path to your Markdown file. And then if you like to listen to a custom port, you can do that as well. And this tool is, of course, written in Mojolicious, but it's like 20 lines of Mojolicious, and mostly of the hard work is done by Remark.js. Okay, that's pretty much what I had to say. Does anyone have any questions about any of those tools? Git-ship, Perltidy, Podify, prowess, TT, whatever? Yes?
Does Git-ship prefer a certain build system? Is it UMM or?
It doesn't, oh yeah, it cares about that. So what it does, it reads your cpanm file, and then it generates the make file from that. So it's, yeah. But I mean, it's very easy to change that if you like. It's so what you do is you just make a new module, and then you can extend the existing system, of course, if you like that. And then you can just define your own template. So then it's going to read the module specification, and then it's going to generate whatever output you like. But I like using cpanm file as input instead of writing the makefile myself, because then you have a lot of more flexibility. So let's say if you want to specify an exact version or something, I don't know if that's even possible in a regular makefile, but using cpanm file, you can do a lot of interesting things. Yes? Yeah?
Just a quick comment about the discussion about Perltidy IRCs. Like, Mojolicious has an official one, so it might be worth checking. If your team can't decide, it might be worth checking out the Perltidy IRC that Mojolicious uses.
Oh. And also just stop arguing about it. It's okay, thanks for listening.
More questions?
Yeah? Thank you.